Last night, we actually had a wedding ceremony in here. And so even as we were doing that last song, which is talking, it's, you know, several images really there in that song, aren't there? About how beautiful is the body of Christ. And part of that is the image of Jesus himself serving and blessing and being the bread, being the wine, the body broken, the blood shed for us. But there's also that sense in which when you think of that song, it just feels like it ought to be at a wedding song. And in some ways it is. Because in the middle of the song, it talked about the bride of Christ. Now, I know, guys, most of you have not planned on being a bride, right? No, I want a little bit more response than that. You say, yes, sir, no, not being a bride, okay? However, there is this spiritual sense in which the entire body of Christ, the entire church, is the bride of Christ. One day there's going to be a huge banquet when all who know Jesus will be welcomed by him. We will be totally and perfectly adorned, brought down from heaven for the bridegroom. And who is the bridegroom? Jesus Christ. Now, guys, I understand, because I'm not like, you know, okay, most of us are not talking about being a bride. But get past that imagery to understand that it's Jesus' family. It's the church of Jesus that will be welcomed by him, perfect, ready to meet him, and ready to live an eternity with him, celebrating the fact that he has returned to the world. Evil has finally been destroyed, and those who know Jesus are welcomed into heaven. That's the banquet we all look forward to attending, I hope. A wedding involves a lot of encouragement. This wedding took place in 2 days. Yeah, and they actually had a cake, and they had flowers that they said they got them at Home Depot. And but it was a beautiful moment, and then it was really special watching, because it was Pete Giacoletti's granddaughter, Jessica. And Jessica is a twin, and the two twins grew up actually with Grandpa and Grandma, with Pete and Anne, and in a lot of ways as their parents. And so it was really special being there and watching as Pete danced with Jessica. Right, Tanya? Just being able to celebrate that moment. See, it's a little bit of the image of what God wants for us in the church. He wants us to come alongside of and encourage one another. Jessica gave a card, Turkey, she gave a card to her sister to read to Mom, to Grandpa and Grandma. Yeah. Everybody was crying as she read these words of love and encouragement. And you see, that takes relationship. And even for all of us that were there, and it was just, I don't remember what it was, 15 or so of us, but everybody that was there felt a closeness, both to Jessica and to James, but also to Pete and to Anne. Today we have a friend who's actually recuperating at Ballard Rehabilitation Center down on 16th Street. Last Sunday morning, we were praying for him. He had emergency back surgery, Marco. And emergency back surgery literally last Sunday morning while we were even here. And he's now recuperating, so hopefully coming home on the 25th. But here's the challenge. God wants us as the body to be able to be there to encourage each other. To stand beside one another. Men, this is a concept that is most important to you. Yeah. Girls kind of like this face-to-face contact, right? Some studies have been done on this. And the girls get real intimate and real close face-to-face. Guys, and here was a research project was done on this. They actually set young guys in a room and all. And they had them sit next to one another, and they had them sit face-to-face. The guys who were sitting next to one another talking came up with a lot deeper conversation than those who were face-to-face. guys, kind of like a soldier, right? How do you go into battle? By yourself, right? You go into battle side by side. There's a strength that you have. And men kind of like this sense of, I'm going to be next to you, man. I'll be there for you. I'm going to be by your side. We don't really like it when they're in our face. To encourage one another means to be by one another's side. It's interesting, the term in Scripture that is used for the Holy Spirit is paraclete. Paraclete. The paraclete, John 16 describes this. The paraclete is the one who comes alongside of us. The Holy Spirit, the comforter, our advocate. Even, what's some other responsibilities of the Holy Spirit? Here's one that most of you look forward to. Conviction. Right? Conviction. Even admonishment. It's the work of the Holy Spirit who comes alongside of us. The Spirit that's there. And how does Scripture say it? It's the Spirit is God now living inside of us. God with us as we've celebrated Christmas. Now we actually have God. This is incredible. Look around the room. Not just up here. Look around the room quickly. Come on. Look around the room. Every person here who has Jesus Christ living in them has the Spirit of God Himself dwelling in you. Amen? Okay. That ought to get you a little bit excited. And if you don't get excited, I will, and we'll both be in trouble, okay? Encourage one another. 1 Thessalonians 5 says it this way. And I apologize. I got to back up. Why am I talking about encouraging one another? Everybody pull out your bulletin, please, and look on the inside cover on the left side. This side, this page of the bulletin right here, okay? Everybody look there. It says, welcome to Crestline First Baptist Church, First Baptist. Now, please read with me the next five lines. We are putting legs to our faith, loving God, encouraging one another, growing as Christ's disciples, and sharing Jesus. That is the mission statement of our church. That's the job we have with one another. And this week, we are in the second week, and we're talking about encouraging one another. The second line that you just read there. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 11 to 15. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord, and who admonish you. Oh, there's that word again. Hold them in the highest regard in love because of their work. Live in peace with each other. And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. What is encouragement? Well, I've already given you some hints. What's the work of the Holy Spirit? John 14, Jesus said, verse 16 and 17, and I will ask the Father, and He will give you another advocate. That's the word paraclete. He will give you an advocate, a paraclete, to help you and be with you forever. The Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept Him because it neither sees Him nor knows Him. But you know Him, for He lives with you and will be in you. A paraclete is an advocate, a comforter, one who literally, the word there means, one who comes alongside. We are supposed to parakaleo one another. We're supposed to paraclete one another. We're supposed to encourage one another. We're supposed to come alongside of one another. We're supposed to join the Holy Spirit who comes alongside of us. We're supposed to challenge one another to grow spiritually. We're supposed to comfort one another as we experience, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, as we experience the comfort of God. Could I just give you a really quick instruction on what to do when you go to a funeral with somebody who's hurting and you go up to greet the family? Do you know what you need to do more than anything else? Get ready to preach a sermon to them. sermon without words. A sermon with your arms. Stand beside them and cry. Put your arms around them and hug. And just listen. The biggest mistake we make is we think that we have to say something to help people. And then we're scared to death because we don't know what to say. Parents have just lost a little child. I don't know what to say, so I'll avoid them. Somebody's just committed suicide. What do you say to a family who's just lost somebody because of suicide? What do you say to that young person whose father just died and now they're going to grow up without their parent? What words can help at that moment? It's the words of love that matter to people. Come alongside. Parakaleo them. Join the Holy Spirit in being their comforter. Be there. The word paraclete always means someone called in to help and to render some service. The Holy Spirit is essentially the helper of all people. The word parakletos has a great Septuagint background. Does everybody know what the Septuagint is? The Septuagint is the Greek translation of the Old Testament. Done, I forget, several BC, but it's a Greek translation of the Old Testament so that people could read the Old Testament in Greek. Septuagint. The Parakletos has a great Septuagint background to that kind of comfort and consolation in distress which keeps a man on his feet when left to himself. He would collapse. It's the comfort which enables a man to pass the breaking point and not to break. The word Parakletos has a great background in Greek law as well. The Parakletos was the prisoner's friend, the advocate, and counsel for the defense. When my nephew was in jail, he watched to see who came and visited him. It mattered to him. And people who never dropped by, he said, how much do they really care about me? And you couldn't really get next to him because you had that big thick glass and the telephone that only had a 1 foot wire on it. But still, it meant something to have somebody there with him. And a parakletos is a prisoner's friend, an advocate, a counsel for the defense, the man who bore witness to his friend's character when he most needed it. I believe in this guy. And when others wish to condemn him, therefore when we describe the glorified Christ as our parakletos, we mean that he is there to speak for us in front of God the Almighty. And finally, the noun parakalein is the word for exhorting men. It's actually a verb, the word for exhorting men to noble deeds and high thoughts. It's especially the word of courage before battle. We have that every day. The football team goes on the field. You know that, right? And to the winning coach, then their quote will come out online somewhere. We'll hear about what they said in the locker room because they won. That just happened with the national championship game. Coach was talking about what he said to them. Now, we never hear what the guy who lost said. But both teams count on it. Both teams, soldiers going in battle, they have this moment where they're okay, we're going in this battle. Now you fight and you fight hard and you stand next to the man that's next to you. And you know that we're going to win this because we're in this together, whatever they might say. Life is always calling us into a battle. And the one who makes us able to stand up to opposing forces, to cope with life and to conquer life, is a parakletos, the Holy Spirit, who is none other than the presence and the power of the risen Jesus Christ. Paul says we're supposed to encourage one another and build each other up. And we're supposed to do that until Jesus Christ comes back. And frankly, the closer we get to the return of Jesus Christ, the more we need to encourage one another. The worse things get, because they're going to get bad as we get closer to that day, the more we need to stand beside one another and help one another out. Shucks. The more stuff on the internet, guys, the more we need to stand with each other and encourage one another. Wade and Alexander and I and a couple of other guys have a tool that we use called covenant eyes. And we hold one another accountable with what we see on the internet. The amount of sexual perversion and pornography that can just come to you freely, is horrible. And guess what, girls? You finally have entered the world of sin with us. Women are looking at pornography almost as much as men. Oh, isn't that wonderful? And any man who says he's not tempted is probably tempted to lie. Just saying. We need to hold one another accountable, to encourage one another on the battlefield. And that's what a parakletos does. And that's what Paul is challenging us here to do. So he says, encourage those who work hard. We need to encourage the people that are out there on the front lines, that are battling for Jesus Christ. You know, we have some people that working New Life Ministries that are actually in Thailand. They go into the brothels in Thailand, and they just bless the ladies that are there. These are only women, by the way, who go in, okay? Guys, we can't handle it. Or how about Rob and Colleen Myers? And it's the moms who go into the raves, and they attend the concert where the kids are there, a lot of them half naked. There's all kinds of sex taking place because they're using ecstasy to get them more excited with the light show that's there. Sadly, there's even Christians that are there who say, oh, there's just nothing wrong with it. It's just a fun and, you know, exciting experience. And the music may be exciting, but the challenge is all the other stuff that's coming along with it. And Rob and Colleen are going in the front lines there, and they're sometimes rescuing people from death as well as rescuing them from darkness. We need to be encouraging those who are working hard among us, who are on the front lines. How about the people who work with our children every Sunday and are down in the nursery every week, who are working hard all the time? You have people like Connie, who's up here playing, and then she goes outside and does children's worship. Yeah, Dave, who comes up on the mountain just to be up here and to do children's worship, and Karen, who work in the nursery, and Debbie, who's down there all the time. We need to be encouraging and thanking those who are working hard among us and those who are helping us to grow in Jesus Christ. Paul goes on, he says, encourage those who care for you. Encourage those who care for you. Acts 20, verse 31 says, so be on your guard. Remember that for 3 years I never stopped warning each of you night and day with tears. That's what it means to care for somebody. To warn somebody. Our son this week, we were concerned about him. He went away for a week and spent a week where there's a girl that works with him, and he does a lot. He's required to do a lot of work with her, and we said, we had to talk to Philip, and we talked to Philip not with a degrading kind of attitude, not with a mean kind of spirit, but a sense of, Phil, we're concerned that the amount of time that you're expected to spend with this young lady, a single girl, puts you in danger. We need to have the kind of love for one another that says we will what? That we will encourage those who care for you. We've got to accept the people who will come to us. Can you imagine somebody coming to you, loving you so much to say, I see you doing something that's about to destroy you, your life, your marriage, your witness for Jesus Christ? How would you respond? Some expletive, deletive, and tell them to just go away? No. Encourage that person who's warning you, who cares enough about you to look you in the eye and say, I love you so much, I don't want you to make this mistake. I don't want you to fall. I don't want you to blow it. I don't want you to lose your marriage. I don't want you to lose your son. I don't want you to lose your job. So, Phil, just make sure you're being wise and careful. And I'm not going to hide the fact, Phil, that I was tempted like this too. And so, Phil, we got to look. Please just take the time to be careful. Yeah, Phil loves somebody. Won't you care like that? Encourage those who care for you. 1 Corinthians says it this way. Paul said, I'm writing this not to shame you. I love this verse. I'm writing this not to shame you, but to warn you as my dear children. I did not go to Phil with any sense of, you know, oh, Phil, you're stupid, you know, oh, you dumb kid, you know. No, I went to him with a sense of love and concern and compassion and kindness, not to make him feel guilty or ashamed at all, but to make him feel loved. Colossians, Paul said it this way, he is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. And again, Paul says that he had this privilege of doing this job of admonishing, speaking the truth in love. Paul says we're supposed to warn those who are idle and disruptive. Warn, it's a putting sense into someone's head. Alerting them of the serious consequences of their actions. It does not mean being judgmental or critical. You see, that's what often happens with gossip, right? Have you ever noticed somebody really blowing it, and what do? You talk about them to somebody else. Now, if you're really holy, you turn it into a prayer request. You know, I'm really certain that so-and-so's having an affair. We better pray for them, right? When what were you supposed to do? You're supposed to go to them and say, I'm really concerned for you and your marriage. Paul says we're supposed to warn those who are idle and disruptive. Now, obviously, there was a context to this too. And the context for Paul to the Thessalonian church was they'd been hearing some people had said Jesus Christ was coming back really soon. Some said he'd already come back. Some, because they'd heard that Jesus Christ was coming back, guess what they did? They said, well, he's coming back soon, so I'm going to quit my job. I'm going to just wait for Jesus to come. That's been almost 2,000 years. It's a long wait, folks. We don't know when he's coming back. We know it's soon, and it could be next week, but it might be another 2,000 years. But in the meantime, he says, there's some of you that have gotten lazy. This is the word for idle here. You've gotten lazy. You're not working. You're not serving Jesus Christ anymore. You're just sitting and waiting. Get up off your, stand up and get back to work. Encourage the idle and the disruptive. Because guess what happens? When you become idle, then you become a person who needs everybody else to take care of you. And that was the challenge that they were having in Thessalonica. You had too many of the people that were there that weren't working any longer, and so now the rest of them that were working had to help take care of those that weren't. And he says, come on, warn the idle and the disruptive, they've got to get back to work. But don't do it with a judgmental, critical spirit. Romans 15, Paul said this way, I myself am convinced, my brothers and sisters, that you yourselves are full of goodness, filled with knowledge, and competent to, guess what? Most of your texts say instruct. The word there is admonish one another. Admonishment ought to be instruction. It's a form of teaching. 1 Corinthians 14, I already mentioned, I want to bring you back to it again. And I'm writing this not to shame you, but to warn you as my dear children. We have a job not to shame each other. Our life groups are not about us, you know, okay, tell me your dirt so I can make you feel bad about it. Our life group's about us encouraging one another, helping one another, even admonishing one another, so that we can become more like Jesus Christ. Not done with shame, but to warn as dear children. Colossians 3 said it this way, let the message of Christ dwell among you richly. Listen to this. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another. Now, what's interesting is the way the rest of the verse reads. How are we supposed to teach and admonish one another? By getting in their face, right? Pointing the finger, make sure you hit them right in the middle of the chest so they really feel it, right? Or it's like sometimes spouses do, right? The kick in the shin. No, listen to how it says it. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. There's a reason why we encourage people to be in worship. Not to be shamed, not to be beat up, but because the songs, the hymns, the worship that we do helps us draw closer to God Himself, and that encourages us not to continue down the path we might be headed. He goes on, Paul says, we're supposed to encourage the disheartened. And I think Hebrews has some really good instructions here. Hebrews says, verse chapter 12, verse 9, moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respected them for it. Well, maybe not at the time, but hopefully later. How much more we should submit to the Father of spirits and live. They disciplined us for a little while as they thought best. And of course, no dad is perfect. But God disciplines us for our good in order that we may share in His holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time. Amen? But painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. Therefore, strengthen your feeble arms and weak knees. Encourage the disheartened. Those who are ready to give up, Paul says it this way in 1 Thessalonians 2, for you know that we dealt with each of you as a father deals with his own children, encouraging, comforting, and urging you to live lives worthy of God who calls you into his kingdom and glory. We have a lot of sports, youth sports now, don't we? And I have to tell you, I've reffed hundreds upon hundreds of soccer matches. And some of the worst people are the parents standing on the sideline. Just saying. And some of the worst of those parents are the parent coaches. Not saying anything. No, I don't know. I didn't see what you were like, okay? But the parent coaches. And I have the privilege of, as a referee, using a card. A yellow card or a red card. And there have been times when I've actually had to use a red card. And that red card means that that person who receives that red card not only does not get to stay at the field, on the field, or in the area of the field. In fact, they have to leave. And sometimes I am so thankful when they're gone. Because sometimes it's a dad, it's a parent who's coaching, and they're verbally assaulting the players on the other team, and me too. And I have the privilege as well as the responsibility to protect all of them. Sometimes we can be unkind in our coaching. Isaiah said it this way, strengthen the feeble hands, steady to the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong, do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come to save you. You see, this kind of encouraging the disheartened, Paul's actually saying, I gotta borrow you. Stand up, please. Okay, feel a little weak.
That's normal.
The word here for encouraging is come alongside that person. Hold them up if you need to. It's the girl at the end of the Olympics. The other girl fell down, right? And she, instead of her running on, she stops and she helps her up. And they head to the finish line long after the others have finished. And she gets her to the finish line. That's encouragement. That's somebody standing alongside that's taking the weight of another person. It's a person who feels, takes their resources, and they think that they're too small for a given situation, so they become despondent, they're discouraged, they're ready to give up. Hebert says they are members who become discouraged for some reason, perhaps because of adverse circumstances or because of their deep consciousness. This can really disturb people. People can be so disturbed just because of their own sin. Oh my goodness, I can't tell you how many people, I can't come to worship, I can't go to a church because it'll probably fall down because of how messed up I am. Oh my goodness, that's the best place for you to be because it's full of other sinners anyways.
Amen.
That was truth and humor, folks. Okay, thanks. Ray Stedman writes that Paul is referring to the one who feels inadequate and ungifted. We would call them the introverts among us. Help them find their place, says the apostle. This is addressed to everybody. People who feel out of it, who think they do not belong and cannot contribute anything, must be helped to find their place because they do have a place. Encourage. Encourage the disheartened. And then Paul goes on, he says, help the weak. It literally means to hold on. Hold oneself over against. Keep close to. The primary sense here is keeping oneself directly opposite another so as to sustain them, what we just did, standing there leaning on each other. Romans 15, Paul said, we who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak. And we don't do it to please ourselves, but to encourage them. And Jude, verse 22, be merciful to those who doubt. That's that word that gets translated in the Old Testament, chesed, loving kindness. My loving kindness is better than life, the psalmist says. Be merciful, show loving kindness to those who doubt. Save others by snatching them from the fire. To others show mercy mixed with fear, hating even the clothing stained by corrupted flesh. We need to so help the weak that are caught in a fire, ready to die, and we've got to rescue them. And folks, you got to be willing to go into the fire sometimes to get them out. And obviously, I've got to give you the disclaimer there. That doesn't mean you go sin to get them out. But that means you love them wherever they're at to help them get out. Again, Ray Stedman writes in a book called Loving Christianly. Loving Christianly, I like that. He says, the weak are those who do not know very much about the doctrine of the Christian life, who have not learned the truth that sets them free, and they need extra help. Perhaps they're not sure of their salvation, or they feel guilty about the past and do not sense they have really been forgiven yet by God. Whatever it may be, the word is to help them, to hold them fast. That demands a little extra effort. Listen to this. A phone call, perhaps. An invitation to lunch or a quiet talk about their needs. This is addressed to all of us. We're all to watch out for one another like this. Now, how are you going to do that when you don't even know the names of everybody here? How are you going to know if somebody's weak today? How are you going to know if somebody in this room is feeling guilty and they're ready to give up and they're like, you know, I just can't hang on with this God stuff any longer because I'm too messed up? How are you going to know that? Well, if you're a member of a 12-step program, you'll be honest with each other, won't you? Because you know that everybody else there is probably just as messed up as you. And sometimes you hope they're messed up more. Folks, God has called us to help the weak, of which we all are. And we've got to figure out the ways to connect more with each other, not just sitting here. How many of you can see the face of the person in front of you? Have you ever noticed how hard it is? Yeah, mine, Wade, thanks. So right now, I'm the only one that has you facing me. The only one. We need to figure out the ways, and that means take the time, make the commitment, get into the relationships, and give of ourselves to get next to each other, to help one another. We are all weak. And then one that I have to keep working at is be patient with everyone. Be patient with everyone. This has been my goal for this year, so hope it hurries up and happens. Now, I like what the literal translation of the word patience is, to be long-tempered, right? Now, that doesn't mean that you drive for a long time angry at the person next to you, okay? That's not long-tempered. That means holding the temper back for a long time. Slowly, like counting to 1,000 or 1,000,000 if you have a real problem with patience, okay? 10 never is enough, folks. Come on, let's be honest. The picture of this word is that of a person in whom it takes a long time before fuming and breaking into flames. Long suffering is that admirable quality that refuses readily to yield to anger and retaliation in the face of provocation or irritation. In the simplest of terms, patience is willingness to keep trying over and over and over again. Some of the most impatient people are some of the most stubborn. So use your stubbornness to be patient. Okay? Some of the most impatient people are some of the most stubborn people you might get to know. Use your stubbornness to be long-tempered. Love is patient. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. 2 Peter said, "The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." Why in the world is God patient with all the evil we see around us? They are finally saying it on the newscasts that Christians are being persecuted the most of any religious group around the world. I guess it just got to be so many you couldn't ignore it any longer. Why does God allow that? Why is there so much perversion within our culture? Why are even so many Christians not following what God challenges us and instructs us and tells us to obey? Why is there so much evil, so much sin? Why do so many people die at the hands of another? Why? And why, God, how can you stay patient with this? How, God, can you not come and destroy evil? What kind of, people are asking this. Non-believers ask, well, if there really is a God, why doesn't he take care of evil? You're the reason he doesn't. Do you hear what Peter's saying there again? The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise. He's coming again. He will destroy evil. Count on the fact. He's going to get rid of all sin. But he's patient instead with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. The reason Jesus has not come back is he's still waiting for those who don't know him to come to him. And Paul said it in 2 Timothy, "And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful. Opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape the trap of the devil, who has taken them captive to do his will." God has called us to encourage and the weak, encourage one another, and even be patient with everyone. And then, as we're getting close to the conclusion, he says, make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong. Said simply, don't retaliate. You've heard it said, eye for eye and tooth for tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. Then take out your gun and shoot them. It's not there. Anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. No, get a better attorney. It's not there. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles, then charge them for the next 10. Not there. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. Unless you charge them a lot, right? Not there. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. That was the Old Testament way. Love your neighbor, hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. That is going to get harder and harder. That you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Even people do that. Are not the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, and the word there means be whole, be complete, be like your heavenly Father who is perfect. Well, in case Paul's more of an authority for you than Jesus, who I've just been quoting, here's how Paul said it. And again, that was sarcasm, I apologize. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath, for it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world, but they have power to break down strongholds. And then Paul says, finally, always strive to do what is good. And the verse says, for each other and for everyone else. Williams renders it this way, always keep looking for ways to show kindness. Matthew Henry says this, in general, we must study to do what is our duty and pleasing to God in all circumstances, whether men do us good turns or ill turns. Whatever men do to us, we must do good to others. We must always endeavor to be beneficent and instrumental to promote the welfare of others, both among ourselves, in the first place, those of us at the household of faith, and then, as we have opportunity, to all people. And Paul said it this way in Galatians 6. Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all people, especially to those who belong to the family of believers. God first calls us to himself. He uses imperfect, sinful people to help others see him. And once called to him, into a personal relationship with him, then he now calls us to one another, to encourage each other, to serve each other, to bless each other. We need each other. I know some of you are lone rangers and you're thinking you handled it alone out there by yourself. And you know, maybe you're pretty tough. And if you're that tough that you can handle it alone, then guess what Jesus says about you? Then you even more so, because you're so gifted to be that lone ranger, you need to come and help the people that can't make it like that. You need to come and encourage someone else. Do you know Jesus? Do you know he gave his life for you? Do you know that he loves you even though you still sin? Do you love him enough to encourage others? Let's pray. God. I thank you so much that when I sin, you are not trying to shame me. When I feel the conviction of your Spirit, it's not to beat me up. It's to draw me closer. I thank you, God, that I don't ignore sin, that it actually bothers me. I thank you that you've given me that gift of feeling bad about something that I do so that I continue to turn back to you. And I thank you, Lord, for those men especially on Saturday morning who are willing to stand next to me and to encourage me. I thank you, Lord, for those who are willing to say, hey, I'll keep an eye on your eyes. I thank you for those in our life group on Tuesday who are willing to pray for me, who are willing to allow me to have the ups and downs of life and not just preach at me. I thank you that there's people who love me well enough to preach good news to me. Lord, I pray that we would be people who encourage one another, that we'd encourage each other to be strong when we're weary, to not give in when the battle is hard, that we'd be there next to one another when we're in the tough times, and especially when we stand at the graveside or in the hospital room or when we're out there and tempted intensely. Help us, Lord, to get next to one another and encourage each other, and even more as the day of your return approaches. In Jesus' name.